Yeah, so today we will see, I'll give you an introduction to visual image interpretation. So we see images every day, right? We see images on your on your mobile screen. We see images in the newspapers, on the TV. Right now you are looking at an image. In the title slide itself, you are looking at an image. So, you know, it's generally easy for you to interpret what an image means, right? You look at an image and you know what it is, right? But that might not always be the case with an aerial photograph. Maybe you might have seen some good aerial photographs, somewhere, maybe in Instagram or something. You might have seen some good aerial photographs, drone photography pages. Maybe some of you are following some good drone photography pages, right? Have you seen drone photos? So you might be following, some of you might be following such pages, right? So, you might have observed that the whole image looks completely different from the, a plan view, an elevation view that we usually see, right? Usually what we see around us is generally the elevation view, right? So it is, what you see in a drone image or an aerial photograph, it's generally totally different from what we see around us. It's a different view. We cannot fly, right? We cannot fly. So, that image is not something that we are generally used to, isn't it? So, you need to develop a practice and some particular amount of skill to interpret a particular aerial image, right? So, in the general case, as a normal image, you might be able to easily interpret. But as I mentioned, in the case of an aerial photograph, you need to have some skills and some practice, some experience to actually interpret that image data to obtain some information from that. All right, and as I mentioned, these aerial photographs, interpreting a aerial photograph, that it's a skill that comes from practice and experience, right? So, this aerial photography, nowadays we have, what is the best resolution images that we acquire now, what we have now? Icknos satellite images, we have near vertical or 1 meter plus resolution images, actually could be clicked using the Icknos satellite systems. Okay, so they have a much better spatial resolution, so the image interpretation will be a bit more easier as your spatial resolution increases. All right, so as I mentioned, from a normal image, your aerial image interpretation, it differs by your features that you are looking at are actually portrayed from a overhead perspective. That is the major difference. Of course, that's pretty obvious and you will know that. And the wavelength outside the visible spectrum. So the images, the aerial photographs that are clicked, they need not always be in the visible spectrum, right? Like a photo that you click with your mobile phone. Aerial photograph might not always be captured in the visible spectrum. They might be captured at various wavelengths, right? Depending upon the features, characteristics and the requirement of the project, based on all these, the wavelength at which the image is captured, the different bands at which the image is captured, they might be outside the visible spectrum, right? So then itself it becomes difficult to interpret the image, right? If you are capturing an image in the near infrared, the green trees or something, they might look red, isn't it? So you might not be able to make out what particular feature it is at the first look, unless you have some experience in it, right? So the first thing is that your images are portrayed from an overhead perspective. That is one thing. Then another thing is that your wavelength is outside the visible spectrum, right? Then the last one is that the depiction of the Earth's surface at unfamiliar scales and resolutions, right? You might not be seeing an image at a resolution or a scale that you are actually used to view an image, right? So based on all these conditions or parameters, aerial photography is way different from what you generally see around you, right? So as I mentioned, you need to have some expertise and you need to keep in mind a few parameters you can consider to identify various features on an aerial photograph. So those features are as listed here. You can identify them based on the shape, size, pattern, tone, texture, shadows, sight, association, resolution, etc. So based on all these parameters, you can identify various features. Let us see this in detail. So the first one is the shape of a particular feature. Let me ask you, will you be able, you are looking at an aerial photograph, maybe the Pentagon. Everyone have seen the Pentagon, right? In the US, right? At least in movies you might have seen that, right? Will you be able to make out a warehouse and the Pentagon from two different aerial photos? Yes or no? Right? Because, you know, these features vary on their shape. Some features you can identify based on their shape, isn't it? Maybe a farmland and a industrial area. Maybe you might be able to differentiate them based on their shape, isn't it? Yes or no? So shape is one very important feature, very important parameter which can be used to identify features in the aerial photographs. Next one is size. How can size be used to do that? You know, maybe a factory versus a small shed. Maybe they both have the same shape. A factory warehouse, maybe a factory warehouse and maybe a small shed. Maybe they both have the same shape, but depending upon their size, you might be able to make it out, isn't it? So size is another parameter which can be used to identify a feature. Next one is pattern. So based on the pattern, can you identify different features? What about a forest versus an orchard? An orchard, you might have seen an orchard, right? So there is some spatial arrangement of those objects, right? Spatial arrangement of those features, correct? In that orchard, the plants are specifically spaced and they are arranged in a particular way. The next parameter is the tone or the hue. So that refers to the relative brightness or color of the objects in an image. Okay. So, you know, it depends upon the, you know, if you look at different types of plants, their relative brightness or there will be some difference in the colors of those green. There are many different shapes of green itself, isn't it? So if you look at two different plants, species, their tones might be different. There will be a difference in their reflections. There will be a difference in their tone or their color parameters, color, you know, patterns. So that can be one example to identify a particular feature. Or maybe if you are looking at wet soil and dry soil, you might have experienced that, you might have seen that, isn't it? Bright soil, dry soil might look a bit more brighter than wet soil, isn't it? So that tone difference or hue can also be used to identify different features on in an aerial photograph. Is that clear? So maybe upstream area and a downstream area in an orthophoto, maybe you can identify that. What are orthophotos? They look like maps, okay? They have only X and Y coordinate. Okay, so you might not be able to identify which is an upstream area and which is a downstream area in an orthophoto. So you might be able to identify that based on the tone of the image, because, you know, the lower elevation area might stay wet for a longer period of time when compared to that of the upstream area, isn't it? Because the water flows from top to bottom. So the lower areas might look wetter and darker, you know, based on the look of the soil there. You can identify which is a wet soil and which is a dry soil. Again, wet and dry soil, clay soils might stay wet for a longer period of time when compared to that of sandy soil. So that also can be used as a parameter to differentiate sand and clay as well. You know, all these parameters, all these color changes or the tone changes between similar features can be used to differentiate different conditions of a particular feature, just like as I mentioned, wet or dry soil. Next one is texture. So texture is nothing but the frequency of tonal change of an image. How frequently its tone is changing. So tone, as I mentioned, it is nothing but the color or relative brightness of objects. So texture means the frequency of tonal change of an image. So this texture can also be used to identify different features. So it is this texture, it is a product of individual shape, size, pattern, shadow, tone, etc. So texture is a aggregation of all these features. right? So you might be able to identify different features based on their texture, because if you look at a grassland, and if again if you look at a grassland and if you look at a forest, both are green, right? Will you be able to identify and differentiate their texture? But can you imagine, can you visualize it? A grassland and a forest, both look green, but won't their texture be different? The texture will be different, right? So you can easily differentiate a grassland and a forest. Similarly, you can differentiate a grassland and a orchard, or maybe you can differentiate an orchard and a paddy field, right? Because they have different textures. Another important parameter that you can use to identify a feature is the shadows. I am pretty sure that most of you might have come across a photo where you see the shadows of camels in the desert, and they actually look like the camels are walking. But if you look closer, you can see that it is a aerial photograph where the shadow of the camels are cast down. Have you seen that photo? Some of you might have seen that, maybe in Instagram or somewhere. You might have seen that photo, an aerial photograph of camels walking in the desert, but the sun is casting their shadows. It's actually an aerial photograph, but the shadows look clearly, there are no other obstacles. So the shadows look like complete, you know, they give out the shape of the camel. So it looks like the camels are walking on the desert, but actually those are all shadows. Okay, you can look up that photo on the internet, or that photo is also given in the Lillis and Kiefer textbook. Maybe you can look at that photo. So these shadows, or you know, the shape or outline of the shadows can help in identifying the profile view of the object. So if you are looking at a camel, suppose a camel is in the desert, if you're looking at it in an aerial photograph, you might not be able to make out that it's a camel. But if you look at the shadow, you can clearly identify that particular feature is a camel. Similarly, objects like this, you might not be able to make out what that particular object is based on their profile view, but if you look at their shadow, you can clearly make it out, right? Further, some objects within shadows, they reflect less light, and that becomes a bit difficult to identify that. Maybe a small bridge in between the road. If you're looking at a purely aerial photograph, if you're looking at an ortho photograph, you might not be able to identify that it is actually a bridge. Might look like a part of the road, you might not be able to identify that it is a bridge. But if you look at the shadow of that, you can clearly see that there is a bridge here in between the road, isn't it? So, sometimes some things you might not be able to identify from a purely aerial photograph, but their shadow gives them away. Their shadows gives these features away. You can identify them based on their shadows. Then the next one is the site. There are specific features which are indigenous to a site. Some features might be observed at a particular site alone. For example, a particular tree species. Some particular tree species are grown only in certain geographical areas. Maybe in the US, in California, you have the redwoods. You know, there are indigenous plants in our locality. So, some features are specific or indigenous to a particular site. So, based on that, you can identify some features. Another one is association. You know, some features are related to other features in some way. Can anyone think of an example where there is association to identify a feature? Have you seen a Ferris wheel? A large wheel. You know, you see a lot of Ferris wheels during this local melas and all, no? You sit on it, you sit in small baskets and they rotate it. You go round and round as a part of a wheel. There will be a lot of buckets in between those wheels. Ferris wheel in amusement parks and all, you might have seen. What is another name for it? A big wheel, man. It looks like a very big wheel, and in between that you have small back baskets hanging down. Giant wheel. It's actually called a Ferris wheel. Okay, so this giant wheel, if this giant wheel is kept in between a farmland. Suppose this giant wheel is kept in between a farmland and you take a aerial photograph. Will you be able to identify that it is a giant wheel? But if you keep this, if you take an aerial photograph where this giant wheel is kept in between an amusement park, then will you be able to identify that, okay, this looks like a wheel, this might be a giant wheel. Will you be able to identify that? In the surrounding, you can see other, amusement items, right? Other rides and all you might be able to see. So you might be able to associate this particular feature with the existing nearby features. So in such a case, association is also very helpful in identifying features in the aerial photograph. So you might be able to relate something, right? Any other example? Maybe a warehouse next to a factory, isn't it? Maybe a small park next to a residential area. All these are features which can be associated to each other, isn't it? Right? Then the next one is resolution. So higher the resolution, smaller the objects are identified. So that's pretty obvious, right? If you have a better resolution, what do you mean by spatial resolution? How clearly an object is visible in a single pixel. So higher that resolution, better yes. that resolution, smaller objects, further smaller objects can be identified, right? So resolution also plays a very important role in identifying the features. All right. So based on these parameters, shape, size, pattern, tone, texture, shadows, sight, association and resolution, I think these many parameters are more than enough to actually identify each and every different feature in an aerial photograph. Do you agree? Can you think of any other parameters you might need to identify a feature on an aerial photograph or a satellite image? These will be more than enough. Most, in 99% of the cases, probably these parameters will be more than enough to identify a feature on an aerial photograph. Further, now coming to image interpretation strategies, there are something called image interpretation keys. Okay, it's a predefined set. Suppose you know what a mango orchard might look like from above, isn't it? Can you imagine what a mango orchard might look like from above? They look like very well arranged small circles of greenery, isn't it? Yes or no? So if you look at a similar pattern, you already have a pattern that is defined aside. You are looking at an aerial photograph, and beside that, you have a list. Suppose you have a list. Suppose a mango orchard might look like this. If you look from above, a mango orchard will look like this. A coconut orchard will look like this. So you can actually compare the actual aerial photograph with a key like this, or a legend like this, or a sample photographs and explanations like this. You can compare, yes or no? So this is called a image interpretation key. All right. So they can be used to interpret, for a novice interpreter or an amateur interpreter, these image interpretation key, they provide a useful reference for identifying various features. All right. So this image interpretation keys are generally a collection of annotated or captioned images illustrating the features. Suppose you have a different, it looks like a legend of a map. All right. You have samples of different features, and you have a graphic or word description to systematically identify those features. A mango orchard will look like this, a coconut orchard will look like this, a hut will look like this, a concrete building will look like this, a bridge will look like this. So it can be a list of annotated or captioned images illustrating different features. So you can look at your existing current aerial photograph, you can compare it with this image interpretation key, and you can identify various features in it. With experience, you might gain more experience over time, and you might be able to identify these features without even referring the key probably, right? So this is what an image interpretation key is. So there are two types of image interpretation keys. One is a selective key and another one is an elimination key or a dichotomous key. So in the selective key, as I mentioned just now, you select examples resembling the image the most. As I mentioned, suppose you are looking at a aerial photograph of Ettimadai. I mentioned we have mango orchards in Ettimadai, right? So I have a legend beside me. I have an image interpretation selective key beside me where I have a sample mango orchard photo. So I will compare that mango orchard photo with my image interpretation key list and I will identify that, okay, this is the mango orchard. This looks like this aerial, this part in the aerial photograph or this particular feature in the aerial photograph looks like the mango orchard legend or the key that is mentioned, that is shown in the key. So that is the selective key because I select examples resembling the image the most, right? I'll find out which one looks similar. That is selective key. Then I have something called the elimination key or the dichotomous key. So there what you do is you proceed from general to specific because you keep on eliminating examples except the one to be identified. I look at my aerial photograph and then I look at all my features. I'll start from the first feature. Okay, this doesn't look like this, so I'll remove that from the key. The next feature, okay, this is also not matching, I'll remove that as well. Similarly, you keep on eliminating various samples which doesn't look similar to the actual feature that you are looking at. So you keep on eliminating various parameters or various samples, and finally you will come down to your specific sample. So suppose you are looking at different tree samples, the crowns will look like different features, different trees like peach, pear, cherry, almond, walnut, all these have different looks in an aerial photograph. So you will identify them based on their tree crowns, then their shape, conical shape or non-conical shape. So you will eliminate these different features. You will identify that, okay, if the crown is very large, it is walnut. So you will see whether the crown is very large. If the crown is not very large, so you will eliminate the chance that it is walnut tree. Then you will look at the possibilities which trees have a smaller crown. So now you are left with peach, pear, cherry and almond. Then you will look at different shapes. If it is conical, it might be pear. So if it is not, you will look whether it is conical or not. If it is not conical, then pear is also out of the question. Then if it is not conical, there are two chances, it can be cherry or almond. Like this, you will keep on eliminating various possibilities and you will finally come down to the actual particular feature identification. So that is the elimination key. Selective key is you are selecting examples which resemble the image the most, and elimination key is you are actually eliminating examples which doesn't match the current scenario. So there are two approaches to image interpretation. One is the selective key and the other one is the elimination key. Is that clear? So there are keys mainly for houses, bridges, roads, vegetation. So for various features there are keys, but it is mainly used for houses, bridges, roads, etc. rather than vegetation or other landform identification. Then the keys for vegetation, it is not very easy to define because it changes from region to region or season by season. The same species might show some different, slightly different features when it varies from season to season or from region to region. Some, the deciduous forest, they might shed their leaves in the leaf off season. They might retain their leaves in the leaf on season, right? The presence of leaves vary from season to season, right? So you might not be able to use a particular key for vegetations unless you know how these keys can vary season to season or from region to region. So that is why generally these keys are mainly used for houses, bridges, roads, etc. But they can also be used for vegetations or landform identifications as well. Then coming to the temporal aspects in a aerial photograph, some parameters like the vegetation or the soil moisture, they keep on varying season wise, isn't it? So these temporal aspects largely affect the identification of features in an aerial photograph, because as I mentioned, there might be leaf on seasons or leaf off seasons. So you might not be able to identify a particular vegetation at a particular site at a particular season. With time, they keep on varying, right? Similar is the case for soil moisture. You might not be able to identify what type of soil is available at a site, because you know the soil moisture also vary season wise. Rainy season they will continue to be wet, and in the dry season they might be dry throughout, right? So soil moisture, vegetation, etc., they keep on varying with time. So it might not be very easy to identify some features as these parameters keep on varying. You know, soil moisture can also vary every day depending upon the weather, timing of the image acquisition, etc. Sometimes if there is a lot of dew, the top soil might look wet during the initial hours of the day, right? But towards the noon, they might dry up. So soil moisture can vary every day as well. So, you know, time of image acquisition is also very critical. So these temporal aspects can also be, it's also a boon. It can also be used for vegetation mapping as well. So they can also be used for vegetation mapping. As I mentioned, there are leaf off and leaf on photos. You know, maybe deciduous trees, they shed their leaf during some seasons and they retain their leaves during some seasons. So the seasons when they keep their leaves, at that time you might be able to identify those particular trees or what type of vegetation is present at a particular area. You might be able to do a vegetation mapping. As I mentioned, we might be able to identify what type of trees or plants they are during the leaf on season, right? But if you are looking at the leaf off season, it might be able to, it might be good to identify urban features and do topographic mapping, because in leaf off seasons, these trees might only have their skeleton remaining, right? Only the branches will be remaining and there will not be any leaves. So you can clearly see what is beneath them. Suppose imagine a urban area where there are a lot of trees as well in between the houses, or in between the building there are a lot of trees. Suppose imagine something like that. So in the leaf off season, you can clearly see where the road networks are, you know, what lies beneath these trees. You might be able to observe that in the leaf off seasons, right? Yes or no? So in the leaf on seasons, you can use the photograph for vegetation identification. In the leaf off season, you can identify the urban features or even topographic mapping. So again, coming down to the type of trees, it also depends upon the type of trees, whether it is shedding or not, whether it is deciduous or evergreen photos, evergreen trees in those photos. So temporal aspects also, you know, the variation with time, that also has a very important role to play in visual image interpretation. So how do you basically do this? How do you do this image interpretation? So first you define the classification system required, whether you want to classify a particular image based on whether it is a, suppose if it is a built up area, whether you want to classify the system based on residential areas, commercial areas, industrial buildings, etc. Or if you are classifying a completely green area, whether it is a deciduous forest or evergreen forest or a grassland or a paddy field, or even an orchard. So first you have to define your classification system required. Or if you are looking at a very large area, you might be classifying it into built up area, open area, vegetation, forest land, you know, water bodies, etc. So first you define your classification system that is required. Then after that, you will employ a minimum mapping unit or MMU. So that is the smallest size entity to be mapped as a discrete area. So then you will employ a minimum mapping unit. Then you start marking the boundaries after fixing the classification system and employing the MMU. Then you will start with the most contrasting features. Most contrasting features, you know, you can easily differentiate urban, water, agriculture, etc. An urban area in an aerial photograph, you can easily identify. Then water, then agriculture, all these are easily differentiable or easily identifiable, right? So you will start with these most contrasting features and you will classify them. Then you will come down to smaller features, or you will come down to specific parts of that particular image. So finally, when you work from general to specific, you can identify all the features in that image. So finally, after defining the classification system required and the employing the minimum mapping unit, you start by identifying various features based on these parameters: shape, size, pattern, tone, texture, shadow, sight, association, and resolution. And you might be able to identify features using the image interpretation keys as well. So once you do that, you can interpret a complete image. You can classify a whole image into different classification systems that you require. That is the basic procedure of visual image interpretation. Is that clear? We'll stop with this for today.